Okay, folks, welcome. I'm going to go ahead and get started this morning, and we're going to welcome you to our session today about the archaeology and the conquest of the Canaanites. And I actually taught seminary for about 14 years, and one of the things that I like to do is to try to give some good information on hermeneutical principles. Many of you know what hermeneutics is, and that it's the art and the science of interpreting the Bible. So I'm a bit literalist, so I think that we should take the Bible literally. And so here are some principles for taking the Bible literally. First, learn Koine Greek. Learn it so well that people that lived 2,000 years ago will know exactly what you're saying. Study ancient Hebrew, except now you've got to convince people that lived 3,000 years ago. And then also learn a little bit of Aramaic and some Syriac. And throw in that 3,000 plus years of ancient history, culture, religion, politics, economics, geology, geography of the ancient Near East, and the Persian Gulf, and the Nile Delta. And then throw in that the same areas for the Roman Empire 2,000 years ago, stretching from North Africa to the southern end of the Iberian Peninsula, and then you too can take the Bible literally. So, anyway, no, there's actually a lot of truth in that. But that being said, something that Dr. Walton has said before, I've heard him say this in lectures, and I've seen this written, and something that I actually agree with. I don't agree with everything he says, but this is definitely something I agree with, and that is the Bible is written for us, not to us. That's a very important principle. So that sort of gets back at what we're talking about with looking at the historical and geographical and the archaeological and historical context of the Bible. But that being said, context is most important for understanding any text. No matter what that text is, whether it's Old Testament or New Testament, you can conjecture, you can lecture about what you think may have happened, but the most important thing, we as New Covenant believers, as Christians today that live today, we want to understand, first and foremost, what did it mean to the original audience? Until and unless we learn and understand what did it mean to the original audience, then can we apply that to us today? So context is key. Context drives our meaning of the text. And by the way, the meaning of the text is not in what I think it means. It's not what I want it to mean. It's not what makes me comfortable. It's what does the text say? What does the text actually say? What does the word actually say? All that to say that taking scripture in context does in no way neglect what Paul says in 2 Timothy 3:16, for all scripture, all the scripture is useful and profitable for teaching, rebuking, and training in righteousness that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. So even Old Testament texts, such as this difficult text we're looking at today, about God's command to wipe out and to drive out the Canaanites from the land, is useful for us today. You think, well, gosh, we live in really a volatile political generation. So we want to look at the historical context of it. So context and clarification is key. So my presentation today, I do have some thoughts on why and the what's and all that, but it's really more, I look at it this way, I look at it more of putting a magnifying glass, if you will, on this time period. And hopefully we'll provide some clarification to this question. Honestly, from what I've heard so far, nobody's really talked about the archaeology and the history of what actually happened. They talk about what we think may have happened and what we think it means, but what actually happened? Do we have evidence of what actually occurred in the archaeological record? And that's what we're going to look at today. That's what I will care about. That's what I want to see, because we have the benefit of history. We can look back and see what actually happened, not what we think what happened. So the importance of contextual studies is vitally important for understanding this passage, but we got to be careful when we get into what's called contextual studies, and Dr. Walton does a great job at that. In fact, I think he's where he really excels, what I really admire about him, and I told him this yesterday in a lot of his books, is he really provides light to this time frame. But the danger is you can go too far to where the text loses its meaning, where it just, well, the Bible is just like any other ancient text. It's like the Bhagavad Gita or the Code of Hammurabi or, you know, whatever text. I'm not willing to go there, because we got the New Testament too. And 2 Timothy 3:16 says all scripture is given by God. So I can't just say that the biblical text is just like any other ancient Near Eastern text. It is unique. is inspired, theopneustos in the Greek. All scripture is theopneustos, is God-breathed, literally breathed by God. So it is both divine and man. Man-made, but yet divine in nature. Scripture is divine in nature. So that being said, I want to give you a few verses here for us to think about as we begin to talk about this context. This was in Exodus. Be careful, God says, not to make a treaty with those who live in the land. The Hebrew word is eretz. For when they prostitute themselves before their gods and sacrifice to them, they will invite you also, Israel, to sacrifice with them and eat their sacrifices. And when you choose some of their sons, some of their daughters as wives for your sons, and those daughters prostitute themselves before their gods, they will lead your sons to do the same. They will lead your son to do the same. Do not make a covenant with them, and do not make any of their idols. And then another passage in Exodus chapter 23, do not make a covenant with them or with their gods. Do not invite them to live in the land, or they will cause you to sin against me. How so? Because the worship of their gods will certainly be a snare to you. The warning that God was giving to them is that, listen, when you worship me, you've been in Egypt for 400 years, and you know how the Egyptians worship. They worship Amun-Ra, and they worship Horus, and they worship all these other gods. Well, listen, Israel, I am not like these other gods. That's the whole point. The whole point of God teaching them was that I am not like these gods. I'm unique. There is no other gods before me. In fact, if you look at the Ten Commandments, the first three commandments are commandments about making images, commandments about taking God's name in vain, invoking the name of the Lord. The Lord will not hold him guiltless who misuses his name. So, and then one final one is Judges chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. This is in after the conquest, and now we're entering into the Judges period, and he says here, the angel of the Lord, and many theologians will take this to mean a pre-incarnate Christ, a vision of Christ, different opinions on that. I tend to hold to that view. The angel of the Lord, the definite article, the angel of the Lord went up from Gilgal to Bochim and said, I brought you out of Egypt and led you in the land I swore to give to your ancestors, and I said, I will never break my covenant with you, and you shall not make a covenant with the people. Remember, he said that in Exodus, you shall not make a covenant with the people, but you shall break down their altars, yet you have disobeyed me. You've not done this. I told you to do it, but you didn't do it. So he says, therefore, I will not drive them out before you, and they will become traps for you, and their gods will become snares to you. And that's exactly what happened. In fact, after that, they begin to say, well, wait a minute, we changed our mind. We're going to go try to do it again. They go to try to conquest again. They fail because God, they fail to drive them out. So we look at what he said, and then we look at what they did. And in between the two things, you can see what God actually meant by looking at what he said and what they actually did, and then the historical record of what we have of what they did. And that's what we're looking at today. Is we're looking at what they actually did. So our outline for today, and I've got so much stuff here, so I'm going to try to get through as much as I can. We're going to look at who are the Canaanites. That's a fundamental question. Who are they? Who are the Canaanites? We haven't really defined even who they were. Historical and archaeological evidence of who they were. What was the Canaanite religion like? What do we know about Canaanite religion? Where do we learn about Canaanite religion? The importance of chronology. Very important in aligning this event in actual history. And then if we can get to it, we'll look at Israel and the actual conquest itself and what the book of Judges, or the book of Joshua, actually says about the conquest. We call it the conquest, and it sort of kind of was, but it sort of kind of wasn't either. Because if you actually just read the text, going back to that principle we talked about earlier, what does the text actually say? He didn't tell them to destroy everything in the city very carefully. He said, don't destroy everything. Don't wipe it. It's not like a scorched earth policy. But you're going to want to live in the cities, but you're to drive them out so that their gods will be a snare to you, kind of thing. That was the idea. So even the text of Joshua even says it itself, that that's what they did. So we'll look at that. So let's start with the Canaanites. Who are they? There are different opinions. This is a huge subject, and there's a lot of scholars who disagree, and there's different definitions of how you define an actual Canaanite. One definition we can start with there were the people who lived in Canaan. So it's kind of like if you ask, what is an American? You know, how could you, you could define America in all kinds of different ways, right? Well, I'm actually not from America, I'm from Poland, or I'm from, but I'm an American. So, okay, so politically you're an American, but, you know, you're ethnically from Poland, or from wherever, Germany, or China, or whatever. But you live in America, your parents are American, you were born in America. So you see what I'm saying? There's different ways to define even Canaanite. There were people that were actually not from Canaan, people who came in, I mean, that the Levant, in the ancient Near East, was a land bridge between Mesopotamia and Egypt. So this is a, Israel, what we call Israel today, is a huge area that where you have a lot of influx of people coming in and out. So you can define a Canaanite as someone who actually lived in Canaan, which we can define as, and that term Levant, when I say Levant, you guys know what I'm talking about, L-E-V-A-N-T, Levant. So it's literally what we call Israel and Syria today up into Lebanon. And the Transjordan across the Jordan River. And then also we could define a Canaanite as a person who spoke and or wrote the Canaanite language, which is Akkadian or its derivatives, and or Canaanite cuneiform or a language called Ugaritic. We'll talk about Ugaritic here in a moment in Syria. People of antiquity identified by other groups as Canaanites. So what other people said were Canaanites. So there's any number of ways in which we can define what a Canaanite is. And then also, we can say, well, a Canaanite is a person who identified themselves as a Canaanite. Interestingly, one of the top archaeological places where we learn about the Canaanite religion is a place in Syria called Ugarit. So you may have heard it called Ugarit, but it's, I think it's pronounced Ugarit. At least that's how people that I respect say it. But the people, if you read their actual writings, the people of Ugarit, and you read their writings, they did not consider themselves Canaanites. But culturally, they were. And that's where we learn about the Baal cycle. We'll talk about the god Baal, or I think it's Baal, that's how you pronounce it. We'll say it the way most people think it, Baal. But Baal worship and Baal, we learn about Baal, and we've learned about his consort, his wife, actually El's wife. El is the Canaanite word for God. El's wife is Asherah, or Astarte, different words, referring, I think, to the same goddess. So there's any number of ways that you can define a Canaanite. Now this is an important point, why I bring this up, not only for understanding the conquest narratives, but also for identifying Israel. Here's why. You say, well, what are you talking about? What do you mean identifying Israel? Because there are some scholars today, in fact, the majority of archaeologists today working in the Near East, well, I'll say the majority of them, but the majority of secular scholars actually think that Israel is nothing but Canaanites. They're just Canaanites that began to identify and worship one god. They picked one god of the Canaanite pantheon, El, and they began to worship him. And so the El cult, or the Yahweh cult, sort of grew up indigenous among the Canaanite population. And they're really not, that's the only thing that distinguishes them from the Israelites. They're Canaanites. They're really actually just Canaanites. But is that the case? This is where we get into, there's a lot of other things that come into this, and that is our understanding of the text, our understanding of the nature of inspiration, our understanding of the nature of inerrancy, whether or not we think the Bible's inerrant, how much of it is, you know, whether the Old Testament's inerrant, those kinds of things come into play here. And even the text itself in Ezekiel, the prophet Ezekiel says this, he says to Jerusalem, he said, this is what the sovereign Lord says to Jerusalem. To Israel, he says, your ancestry and birth were in the land of the Canaanites. Your father was an Amorite and your mother was a Hittite. Now, if you want to insult somebody at a meeting, you say, hey, your mother is a Hittite. And we, by the way, we did find the Hittites, and that they were unknown for centuries until turn of the century in Turkey. They found an entire Hittite library and Hittite site there in Turkey. So now what Ezekiel's talking about here is, again, the descendants of Jerusalem were the Jebusites. David captured Jerusalem by the Jebusites, and they were very likely some form of Canaanite. So think of the term Canaanites as a general population, but united in their religion, united in their culture. So that's how we're going to identify Canaanites. So there are different models today of how we identify actual Israel and where they are, or what's called the emergence of Israel. These are what I call the non-conquest models. These are the models that don't actually think there was a conquest. And this one was a scholar, a German scholar back in the turn of the century named Albrecht Alt. and it's called the peaceful infiltration model, also called the traditio historical model. The second one, it's again, they're kind of variations on a theme. The second one was by George Mendenhall in the 1960s. It's called the peasant revolt model. And then the third model is the one that is looked at today by the Israeli archaeologist Israel Finkelstein. And it's called the agricultural resettlement model. So all of these, what unites them is that they don't think the conquest actually happened if it did. And what the biblical writers call the conquest is actually just people revolting or rising up and becoming the dominant culture that was already there to begin with. And they all are united in the fact that there was no exodus and there was no conquest. Many of them just categorically reject the historical exodus, that it never actually happened. Israel Finkelstein says this: the emergence of Israel was the outcome of the collapse of Canaanite culture, not its cause. And most of the Israelites did not come from outside Canaan, but they emerged from within it. So the archaeological community, the debate about Canaanite genocide, all this, it's a non-issue because they're like, they're just Canaanites. They're just killing each other. It's a non-issue. It's only an issue for people who are, you know, involved in apologetics, and that's great. It's great. But among archaeologists, they're like, yeah, they're just Canaanites. They just killed each other. I mean, they just rose up. But I don't necessarily agree with that. But that's the view. In fact, this the case for the agricultural resettlement is derived mainly from surveys of Israel of around 250 sites. So it's not a result. Finkelstein has been surveying these sites predominantly from the Iron I period, approximately 1200 to 1000 BC. Most of the sites are less than an acre in size and are not fortified. So this is based on I think there's some good things that comes out of what's called the new archaeology, the new methods of doing archaeology, field survey, things like that. But I don't think that he's correct. I don't think he's right. For one, here's one little problem, and this is just for starters here. It's called the Merneptah stele, and this was Pharaoh Merneptah, who was, I believe he was the son of Ramses II, if my memory serves me correctly. You know, Ramses II was the Pharaoh. Everybody thinks was the Pharaoh of the Exodus. He was the son of the Pharaoh, of that many think was the Exodus Pharaoh. And this was inscribed in about 1213 BC, and it actually mentions Israel by name. In fact, it uses the determinative for people. So by the time of Merneptah, Israel is already in the land, and they're already identified as Israel by the Egyptians. Their Egyptians are identifying a people called Israel living in the land. Now, there were a lot of people in that area, the Habiru, the Apiru, whatever you want to call them, the Hyksos. There were a lot of people coming in and out. So there's a lot of things we have to cut up and distinguish between what was going on. But there was a people named Israel, we know from the archaeological record from Merneptah, that lived in Israel at the time. So a very important point to remember. I believe that this actually dates to around the period of the Judges, when Israel was a loose confederated tribes. They were identified as Israelites, but they were not yet a nation like under the united monarchy of David and Solomon. So this fits perfectly with what the biblical model actually shows, the Merneptah stele. So here's a picture of the ancient Near East, and you can see there Mesopotamia. You can see where that word Levant is, and So Canaan is basically where the word Levant is, where the ancient boundaries of Canaan were in the ancient Near East. As we focus in a little bit, I thought I had another slide, but I don't. So the time frame of the Canaanites during this period of conquest, this is again my chronology and the chronology that I follow in the archaeological record, straddles the Middle Bronze Age through the Late Bronze Age. This is so important. In fact, this is a key point of disagreement and discussion among even evangelical archaeologists and evangelical Old Testament scholars as to the dating of the Exodus. There are two main dates, and we'll talk about those in a moment, the 15th century date and the 13th century date of the Exodus and conquest. And I'm going to talk about the chronology and where we place, where I think the Exodus occurred, where the conquest occurred. And so essentially, the Late Bronze Age is dominated by Ugaritic language and culture, or Canaanite culture. So again, fits with the biblical narrative. Who are the Canaanites? We'll go back to this question again. Cultural description, and I don't want to spend too much time on that because I have so much information here. I think I'm covering old ground here. Yeah, here's a definition here. And this is from a scholar at the University of Arizona, Beth Alpert Nakai, who wrote a book on the Canaanites. She said, in the biblical imagination, Canaan was the promised land, its boundaries remembered in the Iron Age, if you're going to disagree with the Iron Age, as indicated by Numbers 34 and reiterated in Ezekiel. The northern border of Moses' Canaan, described in Numbers, corresponded to the linguistic division of the northern Akkadian and southern West Semitic dialects in the Bronze Age. Additional passages further delineated the territory, which scribes also described by reference to the 6, 7, or 10 pre-Israelite nations who lived within it, which include the Hittites, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Jebusites, the Kenites, the Kenizzites, the Kadmonites, the Riphaim, and the Girgashites, and we can't forget the termites. I'm sure they were in there somewhere. In any case, you get the idea of what we're talking about when we're talking about Canaan. So let's move forward here and talk about this. Now, at this time, a very important point to remember here, in about 1176 BC, there was an invasion from the Mediterranean of something called the Sea Peoples, or the Phoenicians. These would be eventually going to become the Philistines. So the Canaanites, they were already there, and then there was a secondary invasion. They were repelled by Ramses III, and he uses the word Peliset, which we think is where we get the word Philistine, is from the Hebrew word Peliset, or Philistine. It's certainly a connection that may very well be. And this is from a tomb, I believe, in Medinet Habu, Egypt. This is from Ramses II, or III, rather. Also, I believe his father also had an engagement with the Sea Peoples as well. They were an ally, and then they invaded, and then they eventually overrun and led to something what the ancient Near Eastern scholars call the Late Bronze Age Collapse. There was this, Eric Klein is an archaeologist. I forgot where Dr. Klein is, and maybe John can help. Do you know where Eric is? Where does Eric teach? Eric Klein?
Georgetown?
I think that's right, Georgetown University. Eric Klein is he's an archaeologist who's written a lot about the Late Bronze Age Collapse. And actually, he's got some good points, actually. He says that, you know, a lot of people look at the Late Bronze Age, and we look at, this is the time period of where I think the Exodus or the Conquest / Judges period happened. But there was a lot going on at that time, and there was the invasion of the Sea Peoples, and what Dr. Klein says in his writings is that it was sort of a perfect storm. Interestingly, he makes parallels between our own day in the modern world with the, we have these displaced people coming from Syria with ISIS going into Syria. You had volcanoes blowing up. You had all kinds of shifting populations that were going on, and it created this perfect storm of major displacement of civilizations. The Assyrians were overrun. The Egyptians were overrun. Everybody was overrun. You had the Habiru. You had the Hyksos. You had the Israelites. So all this was happening at the time. So what it made was the superpowers that were in place, Israel was unstable. Because in Syria, Palestine, where Israel was, they were pretty much dominated by Egypt for most of the time. Tutmosis III did 17 campaigns into Israel. But after, and this is where we're going to get into some of the chronology, his son, Amenhotep II, did the same thing. But something happened in the ninth, toward the end of his reign, actually the ninth year of his reign, where he just stops going into Israel altogether. And his military sort of goes missing. And we'll talk about that here in a moment if we get to it. So really interesting stuff here. There's a painting of that. Who are the Canaanites? Let's talk about the archaeology. And this is something that William F. Albright said years ago in his great book, Archaeology and the Religion of Israel. In dealing with the Canaanites and their religious ideas, we must never forget that Canaanites and Phoenicians were one people so far as language and cultural tradition went. So again, the Phoenicians were later, but they were sort of folded into the people group called the Canaanites and their religion. And they brought that with them. So who are the Canaanites? Let's see, I think the double slide there. Yeah, so two sources for Canaanite religion that we learn about. And one source is written records, and the second source is archaeological remains, Late Bronze Age administrative text. Two important sites, and we don't have time to get into both of them, but today I'll talk about Ugarit. The second site you may have heard of is called Ebla, the Ebla tablets. That found in Syria. Ugarit is also in Syria as well. But the two very important sites for learning about Canaanite culture and religion. And so the first one is called Ugarit, or called Ras Shamra. In 1929, a farmer found a tomb on the Mediterranean coast in Syria. And I've actually seen different dates. Some sources say 1928, one source says 1929. So 1928, 29, somebody found a tomb near the coast. And then later surveys done by the French scholar Claude Schaeffer actually located the actual site, the Ugarit, located about 1.5 kilometers inland off the coast of Syria. And then these are the excavators from the 1970s and 80s, 2005 to the present day, excluding the stopping of the excavations because of ISIS, because of the political instability in Syria. It's been excavated by the French for years. And this is actually the front page of the French excavation report, one of the first excavation reports of Ugarit from Claude Schiffer, the French. So what was discovered in 1970, 120 clay tablets were discovered in Ugaritic language. 1990, 300 more tablets were discovered. And one of the most important things that we learned about from this time period is something called the Baal cycle. We'll talk about that here in just a second. The Baal cycle is one of the most important aspects for understanding Canaanite religion and how it became a snare for the watering down, if you will, of Israel's worship of Yahweh, and how God was trying to show them, I'm not like these other gods. I mean, it was certainly in the context of the ancient Near East, but God is trying to teach them that I'm not like these other gods. Here's a kind of an overview of the archaeological time periods of Ugarit, and I'm just going to move through that. Here's a slide of the actual coastline area called Minit El Beda in Syria. That's where the initial tomb was discovered. And then there's a kind of a map overview of it. So you can see right there on the left, the actual coast area, Minit El Beda, and then Ras Shamra is just right there, located a little bit inland. And this is from the excavation report in, I believe, 1930-something. It's just an old map picture. Here is a photograph looking down at the royal palace of Ugarit. And if you'll notice, on the very top of the screen there, there's a road called the Palace Street. So the next picture is going to show what that actually looks like. So if you were standing in Ugarit today, you can look down that main street. So it's very well preserved, and it's a very, very ancient site, center of Canaanite religion and culture. Some more pictures of that. Here's an actual Temple of Baal. So a Temple of Baal was discovered there. Not only that, we also have Baal himself from Ugarit. This is in the Louvre Museum. Notice it's very interesting here. Somebody pointed this out to me a couple weeks ago. The hat. If you know history, especially Egyptian iconography and Egyptian costume and Egyptian crowns, does anybody notice what that crown represents on Baal's head? It's the crown of Upper Egypt. It's the white crown of Upper Egypt. Seems like there was a lot of cross-pollination between Egyptian ideas and Canaanite ideas. You see this cross-fertilization between, because it's understandably geographically, they were cross-pollinating each other in their ideas. Here's a tablet that was discovered. Not only that, but one thing we do, and there's just so much here to talk about. In the Ugaritic and the Canaanite culture, one of the things that they had some bad things that they gave Israel, but one of the good things that came out of their culture was they gave us language and the alphabet. And the phonetic alphabet, the phonetic Punic alphabet, came from Ugarit. In fact, a lot of the words, in fact, even some of the Hebrew words, many of the Hebrew words in the Old Testament and the Torah, come from the Ugarit language. And there are a lot of cognate words from that. So the Canaanite pantheon, what was their god? The generic Canaanite word for god was originally Elum, which later became El, the strong or powerful one. And William F. Albright says this. He says, the sense of poetic expressions is undoubtedly that El was believed to dwell in a cosmic paradise, just as the Babylonian flood hero is translated to the source of the two rivers of the Tigris and Euphrates. In Genesis, the Garden of Eden is also situated as a source of four great rivers. To this remote spot, the gods invariably had to travel when they wished to consult him. And El was called the father of years and the father of man. He was also called the father bull, the progenitor of the gods, tacitly likened to a bull in the midst of a herd of cows and calves. So El, again, a generic word for God, the way the Canaanites understood it. So usage is going to be important in understanding how the Israelites use the word El in their religion, in their worship of God. And so here's just kind of overview here of the Canaanite gods. You had Baal, also called Hadad, was the god of thunder and lightning. You had Yom, the god of the sea. Does that sound familiar? Yom, the Hebrew word Yom means sea. So the Canaanite god Yom is the god of the sea. El, we talked about him earlier, is the patriarchal deity and his spouse. He had a wife or a consort named Asherah, and later in Phoenicia, she was called Astarte. Then you had Cathara, Casus, the god of crafts, and then Mot, or Mot, the god of the underworld, the god of death and sterility. So there's this interaction between these gods. And then you had Anat, who is the sister of Baal. So this is the Canaanite pantheon. These are the different gods of Canaanite religion. And so we find these gods all throughout Israel. At Tel Megiddo, we found a... this is actually, I believe, here in Chicago at the Oriental Institute. That's a statue of Baal holding a little fan there. This one is also there, and you can really see the Egyptian crown on Baal's head. It looks exactly like, it kind of looks like a pharaoh, doesn't it? But it's actually Baal. And in scholars that I've read believe that he's actually holding a thunderbolt. He's considered the god of thunder and lightning. So they would pray to him. So it had to do with fertility and growing the crops. Asherah, very interestingly, means happy or upright. The word Asherah appears 40 times in the Hebrew Bible, typically in conjunction with a definite article, the Asherah. So not Asherah. So that's led some people to articulate and wonder, is Asherah, does it represent a goddess, or does it represent a type of goddess, Asherah? It may refer to a goddess or a category of goddesses, a type of goddess. There's some good articles on this. So who or what is Asherah? Is it a goddess? Is it a holy place? Is it a sacred shrine? Is it a sacred tree? Is it a sacred pole? Is it a grove of trees? You say, well, why would a goddess be associated with a tree? How is a goddess associated with a tree? And we read about in the Old Testament that God told the Israelites to tear down the Asherah. What do you mean by that? And what were they doing? Well, let's go back to Egypt. This is the Egyptian, what I believe is the Egyptian Asherah, or the Egyptian component of Asherah, called the Lion Lady. This is Kutshu, a knot or a start. Now, let me just, as we get into some of these other slides here, I'm going to warn you, there's some of them are going to be a little bit graphic. I mean, they're stylized, but they're pretty graphic. Not, you know, not bad, not pornographic, but just warning you, just so you know. So, because we're talking about fertility, we're talking about being fertile, that kind of thing, and that was the whole thing of the sexual purity, sexual and also for your crops as well. You wanted your crops to grow. You wanted your woman to have children, a lot of children. So in order to do that, you had to sort of go through the motions of trying to get fertility to come about. So she's called the Lion Lady in Egypt. Astarte is, or this Egyptian goddess. And this is interesting. In the tomb of Thutmose III, you see him actually nursing from a sacred tree with a breast, which is really kind of odd. You say, well, what's that got to do with anything? Well, this is in Mesopotamia, another sacred tree motif. These are two goats looking into a tree, 10th century. This one is in Mesopotamia as well, in Sumer, 3rd millennium BC. So the motif of the sacred tree or sacred grove comes up again and again in ancient Near Eastern iconography and religion. This is in Iraq, in Nimrod, a bearded man grasping a sacred tree. So the idea of the sacred tree comes up again and again. This is a cult stand of El and his Asherah. El and Asherah. This is found in Israel. So on the bottom, when you look, you see her standing between two lions. And in the pubic area, you see, obviously, what it looks like. And again, this is the Asherah symbolism here found in Israel. So that's exactly what they were doing. They were worshiping Baal. Now, whether or not it was they were covenant Israelites, there's no way to know, but these are found in Israel. They're found in presence when Israel was in the land at that time. In Ugarit, we found these interesting little amulets here, and this is where it gets a little graphic, but if you notice here, it's kind of hard to see, in the pubic area of the female, there is a tree coming up out of the area, which is symbolic of life, fertility. Now you see the connection between the tree and the female fertility. Not only female fertility, but also the fertility of the crops. So it comes back again and again. So we read in Judges, it says the Israelite did what was offensive to Yahweh. They ignored Yahweh, their God, and they worshipped Baalim, the plural of Baal, and Asherot, plural of Asherah, Judges chapter 3, verse 7. 1 Kings 18, 19, the prophet Elijah asked Ahab to summon to Mount Carmel 450 prophets of Baal and 400 prophets of Asherah. So even Asherah had prophets. He summoned them to, and we know what happened there at Mount Carmel, unless it's just metaphorical, unless it just, you know, has a moral story behind it, or it actually happened. 2 Kings 23, Asherah is associated with Baal during the religious reforms of King Josiah, when he ordered the objects made from made for Baal and Asherah to be removed from the temple and burned. In the Iron Age, which is the period of the Judges and the period leading up to David and Solomon, leading up to Israel going into their captivity, we find, and throughout excavations in Israel, we find one of the most common things that we find in these Iron Age sites is, guess what? Fertility figurines, Asherah, fertility figurines. And so some scholars will say, well, we, you know, the Israelites, they didn't worship Yahweh. They worshiped Baal and they worshiped Asherah. Well, yeah, duh, that's what the Bible says. And they were wrong for doing it. And they were condemned for doing it. They were driven out of the land. And one of the most well-attested archaeological things in the Old Testament is the captivity of the Israelites by the Assyrians first, and then by the Babylonians in 586 BC under Nebuchadnezzar. We have the Babylonian record. We also have the archaeological record to back it up. So the reason why was because of the pure worship of Yahweh was diluted by the worship of Asherah, the worship of Baal. Here are some more figurines. Jerusalem, 7th century. So this is during the time of Israel's kings, these fertility goddesses. You can see there. This is in Jerusalem and Lachish, Jerusalem 8th century and Lachish 7th century BC, found in proliferation. One of the most famous ones that many people know about today that kind of raised a kind of a thing a few years ago in the archaeological papers, Dr. Bill Deaver from the University of Arizona wrote a paper called Did Yahweh Have an Asherah? Did Yahweh, Hebrew, the Israelite God, have a wife, have a consort? And because it actually says this Pithos, which is a huge storage jar, has a painting on it. You can see it on the bottom left there. It's, again, graphic. But it's Yahweh and his Asherah. It's Yahweh and his wife. But again, this was condemned by the prophets. This was not something that they should have done. But we find that they actually did it. So again, to go back to kind of review what we said at the very beginning, in Exodus and Judges, drive them out. Because if you don't, their gods will be a snare to you. And that's exactly what we find, and that's exactly what they were. They were a snare to the Israelites. So the Baal cycle. Let's talk about the Baal cycle. So in order to understand this whole idea about, well, why, what was the big deal? I mean, were they really doing all this horrible stuff that the Bible says they were? Well, let's look at what their literature actually says, and let's see what they actually say. In the Baal cycle, in order to explain it, the best way to explain it is this. A lot of things affected, I mean, it's hard for us to understand, again, somebody living 3,000 years ago. I mean, I went to this great restaurant yesterday. It's like a, I don't know, what's that place called? It's some standard market. You guys around here know that. It's got like a really nice grocery store, and they got this beautiful fruit and all this. You just go, I mean, this stuff looks beautiful. It looks like a magazine article, you know. You go to the great food there, and you get a coffee, and this great food. Back then, you just didn't go to a grocery store. If you wanted to eat, you had to actually spend the time, and you had to grow crops. And I mean, your whole livelihood, your life depended on your crops. Very, very important point to make. So what they did was they personified the ancient Canaanites, and not just the Canaanites. The Egyptians did it. The Mesopotamians did it. Many of the people in the ancient Near East did it. They personified the forces of nature, and they began to pray and try to affect the crops. They tried to affect weather. For the Egyptians, it was the Nile and the sun. For the Canaanites, it was the weather, the climate, the geography, the drought, rainfall, you know, this whole cycle of the drought or the rainfall, the life-giving thunderstorms. And again, who was Baal the god of? The god of thunder and lightning, the crops and fertility and soil. So the forces of chaos and the forces of order, these Canaanite myths in the Ugaritic literature reflect this disorder, this chaos going back and forth between drought and famine, these kinds of things. And the same thing was happening. It's a great book, by the way. I had this when I was an undergrad in archaeology, by Frankfurt, Wilson, Egyptologist, and Irwin and Jacobson. But I want to quote here Egyptologist John Wilson, who says this about the Egyptians. The Egyptians are doing the same thing. This idea of chaos and order. There's chaos and order. And I like a lot of what Professor Walton talks about when he talks about order. That was a very prominent theme in the ancient Near East about order, especially in Egypt. And John Wilson says this: "These then were the two central features of the Egyptian scene, the triumphant daily rebirth of the sun and the triumphant annual rebirth of the river. Out of these miracles, the Egyptians drew their assurance that Egypt was the center of the universe and their assurance that renewed life may always be victorious over death." So similar thing was happening in the Canaanite Baal cycle. And so Baal was the god of rain, thunderstorms. He was also recognized as the god of fertility, flock, and family. Baal fights against the forces that threaten life, the sea, the river, death, and being sterile, not being able to have a child or your crops, not being able to produce a grain. Mote, death, in the myth, overcame Baal for a time. Baal died, and then he was resurrected. So you see, in the myth, again, reflects, you know, flood, famine, death, rebirth. You see the idea here of the Baal cycle. And so it goes into this circle. And so what they did was, it's something that scholars call sympathetic religion. And sympathetic religion, what we mean is like, oh, well, I'm sympathetic. It means that, well, I think I actually have it on here. It's basically the belief that like affects like. That if I somehow get involved in this process of the battle between the forces of good and the forces of evil, that I can somehow affect my outcome. But here's the whole point of the Hebrew God, Yahweh. God was trying to tell the Israelites, not only contra Egypt, but contra the Canaanites, I am not like these gods. This is not how you interact with me. You don't worship me this way. I'm not this way. Now, he is the God of fertility. He is the God of life. But you don't get his favor by doing these things. You don't sacrifice. You don't engage in child sacrifice, or you don't engage in the way that these people try to affect their gods. So temple prostitution, male and female, fertility of crops, livestock, was practiced by these people in order to affect the change that was needed in the land in order to get fertility and crops, things like that. So does that make sense? The Baal cycle and how they did it. So again, I don't have time. I got 5 minutes, I'm told. So chronology, I'll talk about chronology here. And I'll just talk off the cuff here about the conquest. I'm going to jump through a couple of slides here. So they're basically, one of my heroes is Edwin Thiel, wrote a book called The Mysterious Numbers of the Hebrew Kings. And he was an early scholar. I believe he wrote in the 1950s, Edwin Thiel. But he says this, and I think he's absolutely right. Chronology is the backbone of history. Chronology. Meaning that the date of when something happened, we don't know. We can talk about the past, but unless we have the right time frame, we're not going to find that event. So, for instance, what happened on 9/11? I mean, what happened? Two airplanes hit Twin Towers in New York. Okay. Now, what if some future archaeologist 500 years from now tries to go look for archaeological evidence of the Twin Towers, and they're looking at the time period in New York of the 1990s? Are they going to find it? No, they're not going to find it in the archaeological record, supposedly. But if they go beyond that, if they go to layers like in the early 2000s, they're going to find it because they're looking in the right time frame. The same is true for archaeology. If you're looking for an event in the wrong time, you're not going to find it, or you're going to find contradictory evidence. That's why chronology is so important. Dating biblical events is the source of much debate today. When these things actually happen, and the words of Dr. Bill Deaver, he wrote a book some years ago called What Did the Biblical Writers Know and When Did They Know It? A great question. Absolutely great question. I don't agree with how he answers it, but it's a great question. What did the biblical writers know, and when did they know it? That's a very important part. So that's the heart of the debate about ancient Israel. So there are, again, we talk about these non-conquest models, and Finkelstein today is becoming a consensus. Hoffmeyer says this, and I want to give you two options that there are currently in evangelical scholarship of the Exodus. One is called the 13th century Exodus. that basically places it in the reign of Ramses II, approximately 1267, and the conquest beginning in 1220 to 1230 BC. The second option is the 15th century Exodus, and that's 1446, and that would put it in the reign of either Thutmose III or Amenhotep II, and the conquest beginning in 1406. This is the view that I hold. I hold the 15th century view, because I think that's where the archaeological evidence rest. And again, let me just say this. Both views have their problems. If you hold to Ramses II, your view has issues, major issues. If you hold to the 15th century, it has issues. So it's a matter of, you have to ask yourself the question, do you think this event actually happened? And where do you get that? Do you believe the Bible is inerrant, infallible, that it's telling the truth? If you hold to that view, you've got to place your evidence somewhere. And I've studied this issue for like 20-something years. And from what I can see, the best evidence lies in the 15th century, because I can see it in the archaeological record. Now, again, there's some debate about how to interpret some of these sites, but I think a case can be made. This is from James Hoffmeyer, and I think he's absolutely right. The Exodus and conquest stand or fall together. So if you're going to have a date of the Exodus, you're going to look at the conquest, they're going to stand or fall together. So wherever you place the Exodus, you should see the conquest 40 years later, or some form of the conquest. And so according to 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 1, in the text, this is narrative, this is not poetry, this is not hyperbole, this is just narrative. We're talking about genre, we're talking about context. Let's look at 1 Kings 6, 1. I mean, if there's any dry section of scripture, it's 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles. I mean, it's just pretty straightforward. It's not giving us a poetic, metaphorical, it's giving us a literal date. 1 Kings 6, 1, the Exodus occurred 480 years prior to the laying of the foundations of Solomon's temple. And we read this in 1 Kings 6, 1. If we look at this date, most scholars will place that event of Solomon's reign at 966 to 967. So do the math, that places the Exodus at 1446. Also, if you look at the Jubilee cycles as well, the Jubilee cycles also match this internally in the text. And then also with the evidence itself, we see the evidence of this with the reign of Amenhotep II, I think. And so I'll end with this slide here, and then I'll just give you a quick overview of what we think happened and found. So according to the biblical text, the conquest happened in three phases. It happened with the capturing of the central hill country by Joshua. He captured Jericho and Ai. And then the second part was a Gibeonite alliance at the Battle of Gibeon in Joshua 9 and 10. And the third part, toward the end of what we call the conquest, is the campaign in Galilee in the north, in which Israel, Joshua, did not destroy any city but the city of Hazor. So again, in the dating, I believe we can find evidence for all three of these cities. So what actually happened? We talk about the conquest this weekend. We're talking about what the Israelites, you know, what did God command them to do? What did they actually do? Here's what they actually did. What they actually did was they destroyed three cities: Jericho, Ai, and Hazor. And the rest of what they did was they occupied the land, and then after Joshua dies, we go into the period of the judges, and it becomes snares. But we have evidence of Jericho, Ai, and Hazor. So very quickly, I'm out of time, but I'll quickly summarize. I've got slides for this, and if you want to see pictures later, I'll show you. But Jericho was excavated in the 1930s by John Garstang. He actually excavated there with the University of Chicago. It is an amazing site. It's one of the oldest sites in the world, not just in Israel. The lowest levels of Jericho date to the pre-pottery Neolithic. And in City 4, Garstang discovered a destruction, a late Bronze Age city that was double-walled. And it had a lower wall that was 15 feet high, revetment wall, and it was backfilled. It had another 20-foot high wall on it. There were outer section and an inner section. Both of those, the wall had collapsed out, not in, like somebody pushing it in. The wall collapsed out. When you read the Hebrew, it says, and the walls fell beneath themselves. The walls fell below themselves. Well, how can a wall fall below itself? If a wall is above itself and it falls below, and guess what? The archaeological record, that's what Garstang found. The wall fell below the ramp, and it formed a brick ramp right up into the city. And in that layer, where that wall was collapsed, the city is burned. The whole city is burned. And the city was burned in the late Bronze Age. It contained grain. It contained all kinds of pottery. that did not, the stuff was not taken. The stuff was left in place. Well, why would it be left in place? Because God told the Israelites not to take anything, to leave it. That's exactly what we find. We find everything left in its place, given to God as a burnt offering. So that's Jericho. 20 years later, Kathleen Kenyon comes along. She re-excavates some of the parts that Garstang discovers. She pushes the dating of City 4 back 200 years, essentially eliminating the conquest of Jericho by the Israelites. So the time frame then doesn't fit. So most archaeologists today, if you read literature, in fact, some evangelicals actually follow Kenyon and think that she was right. So here's the question I have. If there was a conquest of Jericho, was that literal or metaphorical? Did it really happen? And if it didn't, if Kathleen Kenyon's right, then where's the conquest of Jericho? Because we know where Jericho is. We have found it. There's no doubt about it. It's Jericho. Now, and we know the excavation. We've seen the city. We've seen the layers of the city. So where is it? That's not hyperbole. I just can't go there. I hermeneutically can't go there. Theologically can't go there. They did destroy Jericho. They burned it exactly as the Bible says, just as Scripture says. And then the second city they said destroyed was Ai, and that's a place that I've excavated in. It's a place in the West Bank in Israel called Kirbet El Makadar. The third place is Hazor, and we also have evidence of the burning of Hazor as well. So I will stop there. I'm over time, and thank you guys so much for coming to my session. If you have questions, come talk.